Well, you know, in most sustainable societies, elders are held in the highest of regard because they, if they've lived lives of service and righteousness and character, they possess the most important quality for the leadership of any society at any time, anywhere, and that is the ineffable quality of wisdom. It is the most rare quality. It is the most valuable quality, and it is always filled with inspiration and goodness. It's more important than intelligence or judgment. It's when all of those things come together, integrity of action, integrity of conscience, and good qualities ripen into wisdom. So it's a great honor to have someone that I consider a wise man, an elder to me, to be able to interview him and hopefully draw out some of that. So I want to begin, Dr. Witteveen, Johannes, Karimbash, asking a little bit, because I see there's a lot of students here. I wondered if you could just tell us about what your life was like as a student in the 1940s.
Mm-hmm. Well, as a student, I was studying economics, and I had chosen that subject because I experienced the Great Depression of the 1930s, which was so very painful at that time. I live in Rotterdam. There were long rows of people to get their meager allowances because they were unemployed. And that put a very dark stigma on the whole city. My father also suffered by it because, as a way of economizing, the municipality put three big municipal services together under his leadership, and he was more an artistic man working for development of the city. So that was very difficult for him. So I thought, this is not good. The economy should not produce that kind of depression, and perhaps then I should study economics. And I found it a very interesting subject. I studied it with the greatest interest. My interest deepened when I went on, and in the later stages of my study, I had the privilege of studying with Professor Jan Tinbergen, who got a Nobel Prize also. And he was the first econometrician. That was quite new, that we could measure different economic relationships. And then he was the first one to build a model for the American economy. I found that absolutely fascinating. And so I tried to do that also in order to investigate the relation between wages and employment. And that was a doctor's thesis I made for him. And he liked it and said, if you add this and this and this, it can be your doctor's thesis. And he then asked me to help him in establishing the Central Planning Office, which was being created in 1945 after the war, with two or three others. That was a great privilege to be able to work there, because all during the war I had hoped and felt really that with this study of economics I could be helpful to the country when it had to be rebuilt after the war. So I felt all during the war I must, notwithstanding difficult circumstances, always continue those studies, so that indeed when the war ended in 45, I could immediately, or practically, very quickly get my final examination and start with Tinbergen in the central planning office. So I studied, of course, first in the building that's still there in Rotterdam. But then we were asked by the Germans to sign a declaration of loyalty, which of course I didn't like to do. Most students didn't like to do it. And then you had to go to Germany to work in the arms factories, so you had to hide away from the Germans. And I did that by going with a friend to a little living boat in the Biesbos. Most of you will know where that is. It is not so far from here. It's a very typical landscape with willows and a lot of water and so on. You could easily hide there if you had the support of a farmer who could provide you with food. Mm. So we stayed for some time in that little boat, hidden in the midst of the willows, and the farmer brought us the food that we needed. And that was wonderful at that time, that food was scarce here, so near to the farm who had his own cows, you get the best milk and butter and everything. Yeah. That was really very nice. But in that little boat, I studied the books around, especially I remember, of course, the great new book by Keynes, British economy, who really revolutionized economics. And I was fascinated by that, and I had other books about that theory. And I have a very good remembrance of that.
So, you know, I just want to impress on the students that you were so passionate about addressing this public need for a stable economy, stable growing economy, yeah, that you were willing to hide in a boat and study with this level of diligence for the purpose of serving the people.
Yeah.
And I think about what my college was like, how easy it was to study. There was, didn't have to hide anywhere. It didn't, it just, you know, when you think about the challenge of studying under such circumstances and that level of motivation, and then after the war, you were instrumental in not only helping to structure the economy of the Netherlands, which I'd like you to describe a little, but also talk about your engagement in structuring the global economy, because that was an entirely new phenomena, structuring global financial institutions. But first, how did you engage in helping to structure the Dutch economy?
Well, the first question that arose was, how could we determine the priorities for importing different goods that we needed for the people and for the economy, because we had only limited amounts of foreign exchange, so we had to use it for the best purpose. It was before the Marshall Help came and made it all easier. So the first question for that central planning office was, on what criteria should we determine these priorities? I remember that I had been working on that, and that was quite interesting. It was already inspiring to work with Tinbergen, who was such an excellent economist, but also such a very good man. I liked him very much. He was really devoted to help the economy and all the people in it. So he was a great example for me also in that respect. Now this changed quickly when the Marshall Help came, and then I moved from the planning office to become a professor in the Netherlands School of Economics here in Rotterdam. I was asked very quickly, then I had to give up the central planning office. I still advised them, but I became a professor, and that job I liked very much, because now I could teach the students these economics that I found so interesting and so inspiring. Why? Because the idea of Tinbergen was, and that was also exactly my idea, it is good to have a free economy where entrepreneurs follow the profit motive that guides them to what people need, because then they want to pay for it and they can make a good price. That is a great advantage. It is very efficient, but it needs a certain climate to work well. And that was also my idea. I was completely in agreement with Tinbergen in that respect. What kind of conditions should the government try to fulfill so that this free economy could work in the best possible way? That was the question. And of course, then the first thing was to have fight unemployment and have stability in prices, and that needed a business cycle policy by the budget of the government, the most important instrument for that. So that was what I wanted, and in my further career I always tried to contribute to that in one way or another to get that stability. Now there are other conditions also. Now of course the very important condition is to protect the climate, which is very much in danger, as you also set out. And there again, the government can, by certain rules, guide the free economy in a direction which is better for the climate, that reduces CO2 emissions. It can be done by certain taxes. That's a very, very present-day problem. We are now creating a new government here, and there is one party who links that has a first priority to protect the climate and do much more to reduce those CO2 emissions.
So you became a member of the House of Representatives. So you were a parliamentarian.
Yeah.
And then in another time you were Deputy Prime Minister, and you were Minister of the Treasury. So let's stick with Holland. So what you're saying is that there were two dynamics that you thought were really important. One is the freedom of the market, to release creativity.
Yeah.
And the other is the role of government to protect the environment that would allow that creativity to take place without causing disruptions, instabilities, monopoly, and environmental. So this was a new sort of approach when you created it. We sort of take it for granted today that this is what to do. But it wasn't taken for granted when you were doing this.
No, that was a new idea, followed from that theory of Keynes, who also were motivated by that deep recession and so on, and explained how the government could prevent that. And I was very impressed by that theory. I'm still consider myself as Keynesian now. And now it is accepted in the world of economics, but applying it is a very different thing. And that is what has disappointed me very much, that the government in the last 4 years has not taken that into account at all. They have had no business policy at all. They tried to reduce expenditures, which to a certain extent was necessary, but they went further, I think, than was necessary, than was desirable, and that was very damaging to the economy and, of course, to the Dutch society.
So when you were engaged in this, the concept of a united Europe was also a new idea.
Yeah.
And now we know that you can't really do economic planning purely on a national level. Mm. I know, like, for example, what is it, Articles 85 and 86 of the European Union deal with monopoly.
Yeah.
And so it's not just antitrust laws domestically, but it's regionally. And I was wondering that you were there when these ideas were first being put forward to create a united Europe. And I wonder what those debates were like when you were right in the middle of it at the beginning.
It was a great enthusiasm. I participated in a group that was very much in favor of that European unity, and we came together sometimes and participated in meetings, and I remember that enthusiasm of all these different politicians, economists, others, who saw as an ideal of that European unity. And I still am very much in favor of European unity. I think it is so important that in this beautiful continent, with such different countries indeed, that we could still work together in economics. After all, we had two terrible wars, and that, I think, was the most important motivation to start the European cooperation first only in the field of coal and steel, which was, of course, a business that was very much related to the war. There we started, and then it expanded to the European Economic Community. And step by step, we went further. And now here again, we have some difficulties, which I think are in a large part caused by the lack of a sensible business cycle policy. Of course, in a European unity with one currency, you have to cooperate in the budgetary field. That is necessary. So we needed European budgetary policy. And that budgetary policy was dominated by Germany and the Netherlands, mainly, who aimed for almost eliminating any deficit. And that's also an idea that would be presented in a popular way. Of course, you can't spend more than you receive.
Yeah,
but that is, of course, not true at all. Right. But the government has very important investments, and so these investments are quite logical to finance the investments also by borrowing in the market. So it was not at all necessary, and it was very damaging because other countries, the countries in the South, had difficulty in their budget, and these difficulties became worse because Germany, the biggest country, supported by the Netherlands, worked for that zero deficit, now even a surplus. And that made it more difficult for the other countries. It caused a great tension in the European cooperation. So I think the lack of the understanding and support for for a business cycle policy is not only unfortunate in itself, it's also a damaging factor in the European cooperation.
As part of this sort of dumbing down of policy, making the analogy of your household, right? We're seeing this resurgence of nationalism, which is a very similar sort of lack of understanding of the way the real world works.
Yeah.
And I know that you were engaged in creating a sense of global economic responsibility, which I think is really interesting, because the wise in all of our spiritual traditions have always admonished us to see the human family as one. And there's been this dynamic of whether it's Buddha or Muhammad or Jesus or Socrates, to see the human family as a whole.
Yeah.
And yet the nation state created, in the 17th century in Westphalia close by, has been an extraordinary dynamic to take us out of the dark ages of the Middle Ages and created an economic engine that's been very productive.
Yeah.
On the other hand, it tends to pull us apart into different groups. But you were involved in the first global financial planning of some kind, beyond just the European Union, but a global financial plan.
Yeah, when I became a managing director of the International Monetary Fund, that was the most important and most interesting function that I've been able to fulfill. I was remarkable that a Dutchman was asked to take that function, which is so very important, and it is, because at that time the United States had given up the convertibility of the dollar into gold. And that was the basis of the monetary system. So governments didn't know how it would work, and it was not so clear that the IMF...
I think people really have to, especially the young people here, have to grasp that the entire value of money for hundreds of years was pegged to the gold standard.
Yeah.
And then at the same time, as we're trying to integrate the global economy, the largest economy in the world decides we will no longer peg money or dollars to the value of gold. We will float the value.
Yeah.
So we have this one dynamic of expansion, and yet the foundation upon which the paper is valued disappeared all at the same time.
Yeah.
And that's when you end up in this position.
Yeah.
In the midst of this sort of chaos.
This uncertainty.
Yeah.
Yeah. I accepted that invitation. But it was also a great opportunity. And now the interesting thing is that just when I was there a few months, there was this Yom Kippur War.
Uh-huh.
And that brought the Arabic countries, Saudi Arabia and others, to reduce the supply of oil so that the price of oil went sky high.
Right.
And that was an enormous disturbance of the monetary equilibrium, and therefore a great problem for the International Monetary Fund. And I then proposed that the International Monetary Fund would create a new loan facility, an oil facility, because I saw that without that, all these oil-consuming countries got deficits, had to reduce their spending, and it would cause a world recession. And to prevent that, I proposed that oil facility, that the oil deficits could be financed on easier conditions by the IMF, on condition that countries for the longer term worked to save energy. that was a very new idea mm-hmm. that I could introduce in the beginning of 1974. And it was immediately accepted by almost all countries except the United States. But the United States, I still was able to persuade also after mm-hmm. some time mm-hmm. so that the facility could be created. And it has been, I think, very useful. It could have been still larger because the banks saw this, that need also. And they also became very active in financing countries, which later on caused all kinds of difficulties. But in any case, it helped very many countries and prevented that recession. And that was a very good start for me at the International Monetary Fund. There was even one of the large countries, the United Kingdom, that needed that oil facility and needed full support from mm-hmm. the International Monetary Fund. And that was a very crucial thing for me because the IMF should not be seen as an institution to finance developing countries. It was for all countries, also the industrial countries, a fund where the countries help each other. When one has a shortage, others have surpluses. So that was the idea. And that was a very difficult negotiation, the United Kingdom. It has recently been memorated in London. I've been there in a meeting where this was again discussed.
Well, these issues are still very present yeah. today,
yeah.
really.
Yeah.
I mean, especially the role of government in providing for the freedom of the market
yeah.
and a climate that doesn't destroy the market, in a sense.
No, to enable the market to work in the best possible way.
Now, so you have used the skills and analytic skills as an economist as an expression of higher values, I would say, almost very much the way when you go back to the foundation of the Reformation that the economics that Hugo de Groot talked about was part of the core of a person's soul. And I know that you were raised uniquely with a profound universal spiritual message that wasn't just harmonious with the best of the Protestant tradition, but harmonious with the best of the Islamic tradition and the best of the Hindu tradition. Yeah. And yeah. I wondered if you could talk about being raised in a truly 21st or 22nd century vision of spirituality.
Yeah, that has been very important in my life, that my parents were inspired by the Sufi movement, created by Hazrat Inayat Khan, a great Indian singer and prophet who brought a Sufi message of love, harmony, and beauty. But one of the main ideas was unity of religious ideals. He showed that all the great religions that have so often been fighting together were really working for the same God, the same the divine ideal, expressed with different words in different ways, but in reality, in the experience, realizing this ideal, it was the same. And that has always been very important for me, that unity of all the religions in the whole world, that spiritual unity, that this does not exist just in theorizing, but in living, and developing a living, deep relationship with that one great being, invisible, untouchable, but still the creator of this whole universe and the protector and sustainer of it. That is a very inspiring idea that has helped me very much in my career, where I always tried to apply that ideal of love, harmony, and beauty. And I must say that I'm very grateful for my parents, who were such an example of that. In our family, harmony was always always preserved. And then there were little difficulties and differences that you can have, of course, in every family. My mother always insisted that we should talk it over and solve the problem. And that is an example that I also followed in my own life with my own wife. We had a very good marriage, but of course sometimes you have differences, but always discuss it so that we could always live in harmony together. That was so important for me. I really couldn't live while there was no harmony difference with my wife. We had to solve it, and we solved it. And that made our marriage so happy. And that same idea I could also apply in my work. Even in the Ministry of Finance, where you have professionally to oppose in many ways your colleagues because they all want to spend too much. I still tried always to keep friendly relationships with them, to understand their problems and to see how we could together solve those problems. And in the government of Prime Minister Piet de Jong, from 61 to 68. That worked very well because he was also a man who tried to guide that government as a unity, not his own ideas about it. He was just overseeing the good cooperation in that cabinet, so that we could keep friendly relationships. And the result of that is that after that period of government, we always came together again for a luncheon or a dinner, and that went on until now. In fact, the professor, in fact, Piet de Jong has passed away a year ago when he was 101 years old. And now I still come together every month with the two colleagues that still live from the time of that government. And it still gives us great, interesting discussions, and we are still very friendly together. So it shows that even in that function, you could work in harmony. And of course, in the International Monetary Fund, that harmony was the life of the fund. You had to work everything out together with all these countries represented by their governments, their governors appointed by their governments. And we had a wonderful way, I think, in the board of the IMF of always trying to reach a consensus. In the IMF, decision could be taken by vote, sometimes qualified vote, but we could vote. And that happened practically never. I think in the 5 years that I've been there, it has happened 3 times. Mm. Otherwise, they always came to a consensus, and that was my task as chairman of that board, to listen very great concentration to what different directors would say, what was behind it, and so on. And then to propose a decision that in the best possible reflected all the different views. And mostly then that summing up was accepted. If not, sometimes they would say this to be changed a little bit, or that should be changed a little bit. And it was very difficult, and we couldn't reach the consensus. And I suggested that we might vote. And we said, no, let's wait. And the next meeting, we will try again. And that gave me an opportunity to talk personally to the ministers of those directors who caused the difficulties. And generally, then they were not so strict as the director thought. So they changed their view. And in the next meeting, we could reach the consensus.
I would say consensus in political affairs, you've just analogized as consistent with your spiritual teachers, Hazrat Inayat Khan's concept of harmony.
Yeah.
You know, and that the harmony is dependent on the resonance of different notes.
Yeah.
But to tune an orchestra, you need to have a tuning fork. That all of the notes, all of the different instruments can tune to so that they can play in harmony.
Yeah.
And it seems to me that in the political affairs, even in economics, that where one would least expect it, because economic theory is so based on self-interest, that the human being, such as yourself, is ultimately the tuning fork. That it wasn't just a theoretical framework that you got from Keynes or any other theoretical framework. It was the commitment of your own self to seek the harmony that ensured the success of the IMF so that it still is a relevant institution today. Could you talk a little bit about, because that kind of harmony in the face of adversity in the world has to come from something inside. You can't get that just from thinking about it.
No.
Could you talk a little bit about how one reaches the inner state of harmony? What kind of work do we have to do as people to get that inner state that gave you that strength and that skill?
Yeah. Well, I think here Sufism is so important because it has an inner school where we receive a spiritual training. And spiritual training, that means that you can control your thoughts and feelings, bring them to rest, and come in contact with the deepest part of yourself, your soul, which is a reflection of the divine light, one could say. That is the central aspect of Sufism, and that is important for that tuning, for then, because you regularly in these practices, breathing practices, mantras and so on, in these practices you come to the deeper part in yourself and are freer of all the ideas and problems that you have to solve in the world. From that depth, you can see more clearly how they can be solved. And also, from that depth, you can understand other people better. And when you can listen to what other people have to say, people who do not agree with me or with others, or differences, when you can understand that and form that deeper part in yourself, try to explain, throw some light on it, then you get an atmosphere where you can work together. I think that is a kind of tuning process. I often explain that one of the very inspiring practical rules that Inayat Khan has given is this, that a Sufi looks at everything from two points of view, his own and that of the other. Looking from the other's point of view, that is not, then you enter in that other, try to imagine how he is, what is behind his view, why that has grown. And then, again, you can create a certain harmony. Because that understanding, that is of course for the other also very deeply felt and appreciated, and the heart opens. That is the important thing.
The heart opening.
The heart opens. Opening of the heart. Then you can tune.
So you're in the midst of, you know, in the midst of the International Monetary Fund, in the Parliament of the Netherlands, in the midst of studying in a boat hiding from the Nazis, and as a great wise man described you once, Bawa Mahayadin, a great mystic that I studied with in Sri Lanka, who described Johannes as the rose in the thorn bush. But that you described that the goal of this is the opening of the heart.
Yeah.
So I am privileged, and I should share this with the audience. Dr. Vitterveen has started an initiative called the Peace Pilgrims Project that is a group of people from different faith traditions going to various pilgrimages to assert these values. So we just had a pilgrimage in India with Christian leaders, an amazing rabbi, Hindus, Muslims, and we're actually going to come to the Netherlands in September, right?
Yeah.
And the group has crafted a statement called the Peace Pilgrims Pledge, to live with loving kindness and compassion, which I'm going to read and share with everybody, and then ask you to comment about why this is of value to everybody or not. So here's what it is. The idea was to try and find the most universal values that every religion should, and people not in religion, people who just care, should adhere to, that a compass point for the journey of life, the conceive of life as a pilgrimage. And what, because many religions have two narratives. One narrative is, we're really special, everybody else isn't. You know, there's a tribe called the Azmat in part of Indonesia, and they call themselves the true human beings, and everyone else is awame, which translates as the edible ones. And so to some extent, almost every religion has this us and them, you know, to some extent. But on the other hand, all of the religions also have a doctrine of compassion and loving kindness. So we decided that we would do this, and you'll see what we're trying to do. Intending to advance peace and harmony in our personal lives and in the world, we affirm the following. We commit to treat all lives with loving kindness and compassion. We reject the distortions of religious, national, and racial prejudice, which are used to violate the golden rule to treat others as we wish to be treated. We respect the diversity of ways people pursue their individual ideals. We challenge the misuse of beliefs, rites, rituals, practices, philosophies, and traditions used to degrade anyone or which lead to violence. We affirm the necessity of bringing loving kindness and compassion into action. Through such actions, we seek to improve the relationships of people, one nation to another, one religion to another, one belief system to another, one gender to another, and one race to another. We call upon all people of goodwill to join us in this pledge. We pledge that in all we intend, think, and do, we shall strive to bring loving kindness and compassion into action and into the lives of all we meet. So the idea is to get, you know, a couple of billion people to pledge to strive to bring loving kindness and compassion into action. Now, I mean, it seems kind of simple, really. But I want to share something. I did a law review article about international security issues. And one night about 1 a.m, I got a phone call from Robert McNamara, former Secretary of Defense of the United States, who was head of the World Bank at one time. And
in my time.
In your time, So Secretary McNamara called and said, "Granoff, it's McNamara here." What? It was like, I mean, he woke me up, literally. And I said, "What is it?" And he said, "Well, I want to cite a footnote you have in a law review article." So in the law review article, I had argued that the basis of international security is when nations treat other nations as they want to be treated. You know, after World War I, there were these terrible reparations put on Germany, and we reaped Nazism. But after World War II, we had the Marshall Plan, which was, you know, really the golden rule. So when you write a law review article, you have, and you say the sun's going to come up tomorrow, you have to cite the Weather Service. You have to have a footnote for anything. So I was arguing that the golden rule was universal. So in the footnote, I had the source of the golden rule in Confucianism, Taoism, Hinduism, Jainism, Christianity, Judaism, Islam, Buddhism. So Secretary McNamara said, "I want to cite your golden rule. I'm writing a book called Wilson's Ghost, and I want to make the point that you've made that nations, that I've learned this over my lifetime, nations should treat other nations." And so I said, "Well, you know, you don't need my permission for this. It's fair use under copyright law." And he said, no, I want to tell you about it." And I said, "Why?" And he said, "Because before I read that, I didn't know that Buddhists and Muslims had the golden rule." Now remember how dehumanized we had treated the Vietnamese who were Buddhists. And I said, "In all due respect, sir, the golden rule doesn't come from religion. It comes from the human conscience. And the human conscience all speaks with God." And then he said, "Yes, I'm just learning that." And so no one had told him this point. You know, this was a man who was the head of the Ford Motor Company, Harvard University graduate, head of the World Bank, Secretary of Defense of the United States, had never been challenged with this universal principle. And therefore, I think it's very important, actually, to do this. And that that no one should go through life and not have that challenge. And so this initiative actually began with Dr. Vidraveen. And I wanted to end this conversation giving you the final word as to what you would like to say to the people of the Netherlands, the people of Middelburg, and the people of the world as the most important thing that you've learned in this journey that somehow has kept your heart young, your eyes glowing with light, and your intellect sharper than than almost all the rest of us. So I want to give you the final word here, and whatever you'd like to say to share with us would be an honor.
Then I would like to say that in my experience, it is the most important aspect of life is to find the real meaning of your life. What is it that you hope to realize, to experience, that is meaningful? And it is, of course, that you find in the depths of your own being that divine light, difficult to describe, because it is spiritual light, it is that loving feeling, that inclination to harmony, that you discover, that becoming conscious of that is what makes your life meaningful, and spreading that, radiating it out, is the best thing you can do for your surrounding. So I would wish that more and more people here, but in the whole world, will differ in their endlessly different ways, follow a path that brings them in contact with that deep inner life that we all have, but we often cover up and put away because we are foolishly thinking that outer things can make us happy. See through that foolishness and go for the inner life, which is the only real life, and which is, be conscious of that, is the real purpose of our life and even of the creation.